And typically in New York State, they passed a bill. It was Senate Bill number 05762. It's called Kendra's Law. And it's named after Kendra Webdell from Buffalo, who was pushed in front of a subway train and lost her life from because some man was mentally ill. Another man, within a few months, was also pushed in front of a subway train by a mental patient. So they're criminalizing all mental illness. All people that are mentally ill have become criminals, and they're going to be required to take drugs, forced medication by judges, if they're judged to be severely mentally ill and dangerous. Now, what does it take to have somebody declared severely mentally ill and dangerous? Well, you need a psychologist or a psychiatrist to say, that person is dangerous. That person is severely mentally ill, based on arbitrary standards of diseases that are created by consensus with no basis in science. There's not scientific basis for the mental illnesses that they use in this country today. And based on that, a judge can order a person who has not committed any crime to be forced to take medication. And if he refuses, they can put him in a hospital and deprive their freedom for not having committed any wrongful act. And that is now law in New York State, if Governor Pataki has signed it. I wrote a letter to him and the legislators. I haven't heard back from him. I'm sure they don't want to hear about it. Too much trouble. It's easier to blame the victims of psychiatric and psychological abuses in the mental health profession. Another interesting comment, this is a report from the New York Times on August 10th, is that a 72-year woman was taken to an emergency room in the hospital. She had shortness of breath, and she had a report from another hospital that she had fluid in the sac around her heart. Why the fluid had been collected was unclear. While she was lying on a stretcher in the emergency room, she had briefly stopped breathing, and they still don't know why. So one of the physicians inserted a breathing tube in her windpipe and transferred her to the intensive care unit. A needle inserted in an effort to drain the fluid around her heart and examine it for clues of her underlying disease was inadvertently pushed too far, piercing her heart. She lost several liters of blood. Because she was a Jehovah's Witness, she refused to accept blood transfusions. She suffered a large stroke. In any case, one of the doctors looked at her and said she would have been much better off if she had never come to the intensive care unit. He said, this is a doctor talking, bad things happen here. You see it all the time. It's probably a combination of patients already being sick and the terrible things we do to them, we the doctors. And what they recommend, he says, most of the patients would do better on automatic pilot if we brought them in here and just left them alone. But of course they don't. And so this is an interesting admission by some doctors that it is the physicians who cause the trouble in hospitals. Now, in Arianna Huffington's column on August 16th in the New York Post, she talks about George W. Bush's money problem. And she said, lobbyists and lawyers have ponied up $3.28 million to Bush's campaign. He now has to show that he can, in the words of former California Assembly Speaker Jesse Unruh, eat their food, drink their booze, screw their women, take their money, and then vote against them. And I don't think George Bush is up to it, personally. Especially when we have this report. Here's George Will, who's a really smart guy. I like his columns. He talks about George Bush in the August 12th New York Post, saying, George Bush doesn't give a damn what you think. That may be why you'll vote for him for president. He said this man named Tucker Carlson did a profile of Bush in an issue of Talk magazine. And he says that he remembers the words, quotes a Bush aide who says, Bush used to say, bleep a lot more than before this all started. Dwight Eisenhower could turn the air blue with his barracks profanity. Ronald Reagan, too, knew the pleasures of salty language, but not in front of the children, meaning the press. In any case, the comments is when he was asked by Carlson to name something, when George W. Bush was asked by Carlson to name something he isn't good at, he should not have said sitting down and reading a 500-page book on public policy or philosophy or something. So George Bush is not a reader. And he also makes fun of people that are being executed, which I think is despicable. And he also thinks that people shouldn't necessarily have lawyers if they're committed accused of crimes in the state of Texas, where he is governor right now. Interesting thing is 300 neo-Nazis got a permit in Washington, D.C. to have a parade, and then they canceled. Only four guys showed up. Police want to sue them now. Douglas Montero, New York Post, made a comment about the families in Littleton, Colorado, where the Columbine High School shootings occurred. And he said that, he mentioned about, talking about the racism and hatred for people who are different that is apparently bred and nurtured in that area. I don't think that's true. I think that's a little distortion. I mean, racism and fear of different people exists everywhere, not just in Colorado. I think what his comment there was off the wall. Power, what does it mean to you? A nice table at a popular restaurant? Maybe just the power to make that sure that none of your loved ones ever has to ride behind a logging truck. To one man, it means the power to forgive sins for the entire state of New Jersey. And that's just before lunch. Later, he might forgive the whole East Coast. Maybe throw in California. Maybe even forgive a man they call Nixon. Power of the Pope. That's power. And here's an example of police just discriminating against people with disabilities. There's a man in a wheelchair, Rodney Dingell. This is from New York Post on August 13th. And he said that... And he was arrested and put in a cell, and he had a gun in his wheelchair, and the cops never thought of searching for it. And weren't they embarrassed? Only because they, you know, people with disabilities, they're deaf, they can't hear things, you know. What are you going to do? Phillip, King Queen Elizabeth's husband, Phillip, who in the past has insulted, this is from the New York Post, August 11th, insulted the Chinese, the Scots, Hungarians, and even the deaf, sent jaws dropping as he visited a high-tech factory near Edinburgh yesterday. Noticing a fuse box that appeared less sophisticated than other devices in the factory, Phillip, the Duke of Edinburgh, quipped, "It looks as though it was put in by an Indian." Boy, he's doing so. He'd do good in Cambridge, wouldn't he? And here's a man that's got attention deficit disorder, and he's the chief executive officer of an airline. And he says it's good. That's in the New York Post on August 3rd. Interesting article. Here's a man who was believed dead, and... who awakens in Egypt. A man pronounced dead after drowning off the coast of Egypt's port city of Alexandria. He regained consciousness after spending 3 hours in a morgue refrigerator. He grabbed the hand of an attendant who was trying to close the refrigerator drawer in the Alexandria morgue. His firm grip sent the attendant and a family who had apparently come to identify the body of a loved one scurrying out of the morgue yelling, "Help us!" Coming back to life. That's from the New York Times. And in Stanford, the library, they're going to have coffee, serving coffee there. I don't have time for this. I got another cartoon to show you. Brother and sister sitting and talking. Sister says, "I'm the real child, and you're just a frozen embryo thingy they bought from some laboratory." Isn't that the way that kids fight nowadays? That's something else, huh? I'll show you a picture of Mike Tyson. This is Mike Tyson here. And we got some quotes from him. Mike Tyson is supposed to have said... interesting guy. He says, "I wanted to hit him one more time in the nose so that the bone could go up into his brain." And after coming out of jail, his first wife, Robin Givens, was famously manipulative. She had been a Sarah Lawrence girl and even in public treated Tyson with an airy condescension. Suspicions that Givens had actually married for money. Tyson was not slow to express his annoyance. The former light heavyweight champion Jose Torres once asked Tyson what the best blow he had ever thrown was. "Man, I'll never forget that punch," Tyson said. "It was when I fought with Robin in Steve's apartment. She really offended me, and I went bam, and she flew backward, hitting every bleeping wall in the apartment. The marriage ended in divorce." In any case, it's been fun here talking to you today in this rotten hot day. You want to call in, right? You got phone numbers, you got email, anything you want to do. This has been Roy Bercaw. And that's Bo Diddley. And if you know Bo Diddley from 1950, saw a film the other day, The Day the Earth Stood Still, also from 1951. Interesting stuff they made back 45 years ago. If you want to know about the past, this is the present. Bo Diddley, Roy Bercaw, and Enough Room right here on CCTV Channel 9. Every Wednesday, 4:30, 9 o'clock.